All right, folks, my name is Sam Estreicher. I teach here at the law school, and I'm the faculty director of the Center for Labor and Employment Law. This is a joint activity, a partnership with Professor Jerry Cohen's U.S. Asia Law Institute. Che Guevara said, 1, 2, 3, many Vietnams, and I want to say 1, 2, 3, many cooperative relationships with Professor Cohen's institute. And we're hoping to make this an annual evening program on human rights in China. Of course, the issues will change over time, but to sort of put the issue on the agenda of our law school community. I want to thank Tori Whitman and Aaliyah from our Labor Center for the logistic efforts that they engaged in. Ruth Gao, Ruth, where are you, Ruth? Ruth helped put together. She's a first-year law student, and I dragooned her into this activity, and she's been fantastic. She's also one of Jerry Cohen's many intelligent and energetic acolytes. So I'm going to call you a Cohen acolyte, which is not a bad thing, Ruth. But Ruth has been terrific. I want to thank you all for coming. This is going to be the format. I'll introduce the speakers very briefly, and the two speakers to my right have 20 minutes, and Colin Gillespie will have 10, 15 minutes, as much time as he wants. Then we'll open it up to Q&A, and we'll go until about 9 o'clock, and then there's a reception outside after the program. Jerry Cohen, you all know, he needs no introduction. There is no one in China legal studies in the United States that hasn't been a student of Jerry's, including people who are not in China legal studies, like myself. We've all been, we've brushed up against greatness by being involved with Jerry. Jerry has enormous credibility in China. I was in Nanjing with him and Professor Eslin and a few other people. For 2.5 hours, he had almost the entire Chinese criminal law community at a lecture, and you know, he's not the youngest man. He's at least 60, as far as I can tell. But at 8 o'clock, until 10 o'clock, speaking in Mandarin, his jokes were in Mandarin, his comeback was in Mandarin. He had all the defense lawyers there, the prosecutors, the judges. You would have thought that this man was the dean, not only of Chinese legal studies in the United States, but Chinese legal studies in China. And it's really great to be in this joint partnership with him. Jerry is going to speak for 20 minutes on the general landscape of issues involving human rights. He's been very prominent on many of these issues. Then our next speaker will be David Matus. David is a very well-known international human rights lawyer. His entire career is human rights practice. He's based in Manitoba in Canada. And has been very active in a whole range of issues. But what he's going to focus on tonight is the treatment of the Falun Gong group in China. And he has done a book on a very controversial issue, and we'll talk something about it, on whether or not the Chinese state is involved in forcible body donations of Falun Gong practitioners, but there are also other human rights issues associated with the Falun Gong. Colin Gillespie is a third-year student at the law school. He's also one of my dragoonies, like Ruth. He was doing a paper on some international human rights issue. I said, why don't you do it on sort of human rights in practice? Look at the asylum applications and how they're faring of Falun Gong practitioners in the United States. And he's put together a very interesting paper, which is available here on the chair here in front, in the back. When you get a chance, please read it. It's extremely well done. And so I want him to present some of his preliminary findings to you. We begin with Professor Cohen.
You see why I like to cooperate with Professor Estreicher. He knows that man lives by psychic income. It's not taxable. In any event, I'm very glad that we could do this evening. I didn't realize our timing would so coincide with the most recent human rights violation of the Chinese government. Unfortunately, my friend Ai Weiwei, whom I've known for 25 years, as every media we have tells us, is locked up, and I'll refer to that later. But let me start with the term defining moment. A couple of years ago, that was a very prominent cliche. Every day you'd hear on the radio, TV, or in a newspaper, you'd read, "This may be the defining moment." I didn't use that locution, but in preparing for tonight, I really do come to the thought that this may be a defining moment with respect to China and human rights. And I'll hope to spell out what I mean by that before I'm done. First, two caveats. One is we're talking about China, but we have to avoid the danger it's so easy to fall into of only focusing on China and not looking at ourselves. The worst kind of comparative law is to compare our theory and their practice. And we have to look at all the human rights problems that the United States continues to struggle with, whether it be sort of the glamorous items that capture the front page of the press, Guantanamo, who will try the prisoners, what will happen in the struggle between national security and our own traditional constitutional rights. There are a lot of DNA police abuse problems. We read about them all the time. We're lucky, however, that we do have a free press. We do have a functioning democratic system. We do have lawyers available, fairly independent judges. All of these things have imperfections that we constantly have to work toward. And we have some enduring institutional questions: the impact on justice of race, poverty. What do we do about the death penalty in our country? That's one thing we have in common with China. We're both on the wrong side of history, to use another cliche with respect to the death penalty. So the first thing is to be aware of what the Scottish poet said a long time ago: "Oh, would the Lord this gift he gie us, to see ourselves as others see us." A second caveat I want to talk about is the limits of human rights discourse tonight. Human rights is so broad. If you look at all the relevant conventions, you'll see a huge amount of human activity is covered. And every country has its own flourishes, its own particular preoccupation. In the post-World War II era, Japan, which became notorious for its success in exporting, there was a case, I think it was 1956, in the Tokyo District Court involving the right of Japanese companies to export to China. And the trading companies of Japan argued in court, and they persuaded the district court to write an opinion that said, "The right to export is a fundamental human right." And at the time we thought, what other country would define human rights in such a broad way? Of course, we have our own interests and China has its. China has made, as we all know, enormous progress, certainly since my first visit there, 1972. We've seen this stunning economic development for 30 years, 10% growth year after year, transforming the Chinese economy, China's impact on the world, and transforming to a considerable, but not entire extent, Chinese society, especially urban life. And the usual cliche here is to point out the Chinese government has taken several hundred million people out of poverty. And we'll note this migration to the cities, this rise from poverty is likely to continue, although there will be some severe bumps in the road, I'm sure. But we're not talking tonight about economic, social, and cultural rights. China, it should be noted, has ratified the relevant international covenant, has begun to report through the required processes, and although enforcement of its obligations is certainly imperfect, their progress has certainly been made. But tonight, we're talking about human rights in a narrower sense, a sense that normally concerns us in the West, human rights in the sense of civil and political rights. The Chinese government, for its own good reasons, 1998, signed the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. That covenant, if ratified by China, would have profound effects on Chinese, not only political life, but also social life, intellectual life, cultural life. WTO commitments have begun over the last 16 years or more to change China's whole economic structure, domestic, international. It's having a great effect on Chinese legislation, adjudication, administration, and economic development. But ratification of the ICCPR would have a more profound effect because it calls, on the one hand, for substantive freedoms, freedom of expression of every kind, freedom of religion, but also procedural due process of law, fairness in the administration of justice. It would force China to do away with Laodong Zhaoyang, re-education through labor. It would force the criminal process of China to undergo many important changes, and you'll get some examples of that a little later when I mention the Ai Weiwei case. But that's the definition of what we're talking about tonight. Now, there is in China a struggle underway. Because the government keeps the country largely non-transparent, although it's increasingly difficult to do so, it's hard to see some of that struggle, especially since many of the interests that are calling for improvements in human rights and in the administration of justice are coming from the losers in Chinese society, or at least from those who, relatively speaking, have not gained as much from this fabulous 30-year modernization as the urban entrepreneurs. You could call them the urban bourgeoisie. Traditionally in the West, in France, for example, we associate the rise of human rights in the sense we're using them tonight with the rising bourgeoisie that demands protection against the king and the nobility, et cetera, and they wanted legal change. We don't see that so much in China today. The entrepreneurs in China seem quite happy. They've been taken into the party, into the system. They've been succeeding admirably. They can rely on guanxi relationships. They can rely on money, contacts of all kinds. It's the people who haven't had such a rise who are increasingly looking to constitutional rights, legislative, even regulatory rights, and trying increasingly to invoke them. You also have, of course, a large intellectual class, as well as many members of the official class, who, while they outwardly do what the party requires, inwardly are hoping for a freer development in their society. And in a way, the Communist Party leadership is a victim of its own success, precisely because it has not only fostered economic development and social change that it can't entirely control, but also because it has done a lot to spread ideas of human rights. It put into the Constitution of China amendments calling for human rights protection, as well as protection of property rights. It has enacted the legislation to implement a lot of the constitutional promises. It has created a legal education system that has just grown like Topsy. When I first went to China in 1972, there was nothing going on in legal education. A lot of the law professors were down on the farm having their heads reshaped or hiding out at home, hoping the Cultural Revolution wouldn't reach them. And I went out to Peking University, couldn't find anybody. The next year, they came up with two rather frightened professors. They looked a lot healthier than I did because they were suntanned from working in the fields. I'd been working in the Harvard Law School library. I didn't look so good. And they wouldn't say anything. First of all, they had nothing to say. There was nothing to show me to talk about in those days. And also, they had been victimized during not only the Cultural Revolution, but years before that in the anti-rightist movement that started in 57, 58. So today in China, legal education has proved to be one of the biggest products of phenomenal educational development. Over 700 law schools and law departments, too many adequately to staff. But with a large group of people training them, and with several hundred thousand people taking the bar exam for judges, prosecutors, and lawyers, and in every place you look, you see lawyers, not only 160 or 70,000 practicing lawyers, but lawyers who staff every government agency, lawyers who are on the staff of the National People's Congress, lawyers who are in every rising company, whether state-owned, private, or mixed. You can't function now without having lawyers, and some of these lawyers, unfortunately only a small minority, are human rights lawyers or lawyers for NGOs. And despite restrictions, non-governmental organizations in China have been growing, and they have been regulated. And this should be seen by the party as an advantage. They're beginning to see it now since the color revolutions of Eastern Europe as a disadvantage. But my point is the Communist Party leadership itself has contributed to expectations that people will have rights and will be able to enjoy them. And the problem the party has is quite a few people are trying to implement those rights and exercise them. And that has created difficulty. People like Ai Weiwei didn't complain 20 years ago, but he's typical, now 53 years old, of people who've come through a different era, a different experience, live in a different world, and are beginning to assert themselves. I think you've had distributed one page about the human rights situation in the week of March 28th to April 4th. I just thought it's a way to show the range of human rights violations that we read about every day. And I can't go into it, but it shows the breadth of striving on the part of many people, and it shows the breadth of the government striving to suppress them. And I think it's the wrong response. I think it's sad that a government that has done so much to help the masses of people in China and that has made such a deep impact, even leaving many of the other countries of the world in fear about Chinese domination, that this government should be so frightened. And the Jasmine Revolution, so-called, has only proved to be the most recent demonstration that this leadership is running scared. Despite their success, they know a lot more about the tensions within Chinese society than we do on the outside. And yet, they feel a single spark, as Chairman Mao said, can start a prairie fire. Since June 4th, 1989, we've seen enormous effort to snuff out anything that looked like another spark. And that's, of course, why the Falun Gong proved to be so frightening 10 years later after June 4th in 1999. Ai Weiwei is the symbol now of the attempt by his generation and younger people to assert individual rights in the face of a repressive state. He's been carrying this campaign on progressively. I've been increasingly worried that it's obvious he wasn't going to get away with it forever. I had the feeling I had in January, February 1979. I was living in Beijing. I would go every day to Democracy Wall, and I would listen to the speakers. And it was exhilarating to see the free speech in Beijing at that time. And you couldn't help but sympathize with these tales of accumulated horror going back to the anti-rightist movement 20 years earlier. But you knew it couldn't last. You knew there would have to be a crackdown. And Weiwei has been pushing the frontier of this. He got his head handed to him, almost literally, in Chengdu when the police beat him in an illegal search of his hotel. But he fought back. I don't know how many of you have seen the video he did of his attempts to hold the Chengdu police accountable. And when you watch his aggressive behavior, trying to get the police to respond to his questions about their abuses, I begin to feel sorry for the policeman, because Weiwei is really an in-your-face person. Well, now it looks like, as part of this new dimension we're witnessing in recent months of Chinese repression — this isn't a recycling that just happens periodically, it's more than a response, I think, to the movement in Eastern Europe and now the movement in North Africa and elsewhere. I think this is a new effort to build a system we haven't seen before, in which law will play a role as a repressor of conduct, but in which they won't rely on law itself. As the spokesman for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs said a week or two ago, he said, law's not going to be a protection for anybody who tries to bring the Jasmine Revolution to China. There's a new social system forming. It's been coming along for some time. You can trace it back in the speeches of Zhou Yongkang, who used to be Minister of Public Security, is now the head of the National Communist Party political legal apparatus that runs all legal entities in China. Now, Weiwei's case, and this may be his ultimate contribution to human rights, I think is going to illustrate for the world the deficiencies of the criminal justice system in China. Right now, we don't know whether he even will have a lawyer. I think the family is understandably hesitating. They have some very good lawyers who have made themselves available, but they're uncertain. There's always an instinct when a case like this breaks out, even if it's publicized already, for the family, being Chinese, to think, don't go formal. Don't get into the legal justice system prematurely until you have to. Don't make it a criminal case too quickly. So don't get a lawyer. Try to use Guanxi behind the scenes efforts to work this thing out. And he has some connections, but maybe not sufficient at this point. So one problem is, should they have a lawyer now? Second, which lawyer, and what can a lawyer do? There has been no notice of detention given to Weiwei's family. So there's no confirmation by the police of where he is, who's holding him, or what he's suspected of. Without a notice of detention, it's very hard for the lawyer to go to the public security and say, I have a right to see this man. See our 2007 lawyer's law. And under the criminal procedure law, you don't have, if you're a lawyer, an absolute right to see your client. The police can say, no, this case involves state secrets. And there's no way of challenging that, just as there's no way of forcing the police to give a notice of detention. They're entitled not to give such a notice if they say to do so would interfere with the investigation. But there's no way to challenge their unilateral interpretation that to give notice would interfere with the investigation, to allow the lawyer to see the detained person would violate the state secrets provision. And if the lawyer gets to see the detained person, there are strict limits. How long can he stay? And what can they talk about? Can he give him full legal advice? Under Chinese criminal procedure law, at this stage, the lawyer is not considered a defense lawyer. He's considered a kind of legal advisor. He can ask for bail. He can give some very general comments. But the lawyer can tell the detained person he's very unlikely to get bail. So-called chubao hoshun, obtaining a guarantee pending trial, isn't often granted. And when it is, it's at the convenience of the police. If you get detained in China and are going to pursue you for a criminal prosecution, you're not going to get bail in most cases unless the jail is too full or you've already spilled out your guts, etc. All of these are very important because the danger once you're detained is the pressures to start confessing become very great. Torture risk in China is very, very high. And the whole idea of getting the lawyer in soon is to try to reduce the likelihood that this will happen. So we don't know, of course, whether the lawyer will be allowed not only to see his client, but to do any independent investigation. Most criminal lawyers in China feel it's too dangerous to engage in independent investigation, to interview witnesses. You lay yourself open to a subsequent charge of inducing perjury, falsifying evidence, if the witness tells you something different from what the witness has already told the police. So these are problems of the early stage. Now we heard this afternoon, very briefly, a Xinhua dispatch that said Ai Weiwei has been detained for investigation of economic crimes. And we have suspected for some time they'll try to pin a tax rap on him. The US legal system occasionally has sent famous gangsters to jail for failing to pay their taxes. Al Capone, the famous Chicago gangster, is the classic case. We've seen this tax gambit used against certain NGOs and activists already in China. The interesting thing is, A, Xinhua felt obliged to put out this release, but then almost instantly felt obliged to withdraw it, and you can't find it. Now that's a sign that the leadership is in some disarray, that some high leader must have become angry when he saw a release was put out. That's the usual explanation. In most cases, China doesn't show signs of disarray, but in some very sensitive cases, I was involved with one involving the New York Times some years ago, and there was a 24-hour period when the Foreign Ministry and the Ministry of Public Security and the Ministry of State Security and the media were not on the same page. But they soon got over it after a very embarrassing incident. So here, this is a sign, potentially, of tension. Well, we don't know what's going to happen. As I said earlier, people are speculating about the meaning of this whole campaign. But I think it goes far beyond anything temporary. And I think many of the people who staff the courts, the prosecutor's office, the legal profession, and academic work and lawyers, et cetera, I think they know that they're losing the struggle to make China more a country under law than a country simply using law when it's convenient for the leader's repression or economic activity. The Wall Street Journal today had I don't often agree with some of their editorials, but they had one on Weiwei's case today where they quoted some things that he said. And one of the things he asked couple of years ago is, what kind of a monster will China become? What we're asking in less in-your-face language is, what kind of a China will this government lead people to? Will there be a big change next year when you have the 18th Party Congress? I think it depends not only on what happens internally within China, but also depends a lot on what happens externally. So that leaves us with the famous question Lenin used for his most famous book, what is to be done? What can we do on the outside? People outside of China generally have very little influence on what takes place, and yet the Chinese government is very sensitive to what foreigners say. It doesn't mean it will take our opinion as more important than some of the internal factors that govern its behavior, but they certainly, China wants soft power. That's why Confucius has replaced Karl Marx in Tiananmen Square. That's why they established these Confucius Institutes. That's why they've resurrected the great sage. They want to have a reputation not only as a military power and an economic power, but they want to be known as a great civilization. And China should be. But this is not the way to do it.
Thank you, Jerry. We're now going to turn to Mr. Matus, and it's all yours.
Okay. Thank you very much. First of all, I appreciate the fact that I am invited here. As Sam Estreicher has said, I'm from Winnipeg. Now, in Winnipeg, the definition of an expert is somebody who's not from Winnipeg. Of course, New York is at the pinnacle of expertise. And for New York to invite somebody from Winnipeg to come to speak to them is
first for us.
I am sure an inversion of the order of things, which gives me hope for other inversions.
More to come.
I also am pleased to be on the panel with Jerry Cohen, who I've had the pleasure of cross-examining. I am a lawyer in private practice, and Jerry Cohen was an expert witness for the other side in one of my cases. And I'm pleased to see that he's willing to share the podium with me, and we remain on good terms nonetheless.
You were very tough.
Yeah, and my client's still in Canada.
That's right. Now,
David Kilgore and I have done a report in two versions, and then a book, which concluded that the Chinese Communist Party state has been killing Falun Gong for their organs. I've got a couple copies of the book here, one that a library copy, and this is the soft cover copy. The killing, according to our conclusions, has been inflicted since 2001. The organs are sold to patients who need organ transplants. Our two reports came out in July 2006 and January 2007, and our book came out in November 2009. Our reports are available on the internet. Falun Gong is a set of exercises with the spiritual foundation. It started in 1992 with the teachings of Li Hongji. By June 1999, it had become so popular and widespread that the Communist Party feared for its ideological supremacy and banned the movement. David Kilgore and I did our reports and book because we are human rights researchers, writers, and advocates. The issue whether Falun Gong were being killed for their organs needed investigation. There were allegations and denials about the killing of Falun Gong for their organs. The issue needed investigation, so we did the investigation as volunteers. After we concluded that Falun Gong were being killed for their organs, we could not just walk away from our conclusions. Our advocacy mode kicked in, trying to end the abuse we identified. We spoke in over 40 countries and over 80 cities. We met with academics, parliamentarians, diplomats, ethicists, transplant professionals, media, non-governmental organizations, intergovernmental mechanisms, whoever we could, wherever we could, to try to stop the abuse. Now, this panel here has a much larger focus than organ transplant abuse of the Falun Gong. It is dealing with all human rights in China, a very large topic indeed. David Kilgore and I did not start out in our efforts with the goal of ending all human rights abuses in China. We did not strategize thinking that what we were doing was strategically the best way to go about ending human rights abuses in China. And superficially, if that is the goal, ending generally human rights abuse in China, doing what we did is not the obvious strategic choice for a couple of reasons. For one, the government of China and the Communist Party wants no part of discussions of the victimization of the Falun Gong. Talk with Chinese government representatives about their justice system or their health system or many other components of the society which raise human rights concerns. The party and state representatives will say, "We're trying to do better, give us time, we need your help." Raise, however, with Chinese officials the persecution of Falun Gong, they will insult, they will harangue, they will propagandize, they will turn a deaf ear, they will walk out of the room. So that's one problem. Secondly, the killing of Falun Gong, though established, I believe, by the work David Kilgore and I have done, requires a good deal more time assessing the evidence than many other abuses. Torture is easily documented because we have surviving torture victims carrying on their bodies the signs of torture. Forced labor is similarly easy to prove because we have survivors of the Chinese forced labor camps who live to tell us their tales, and I see one of the survivors here. The killing of someone for their organs, by definition, leaves no survivors. There's even no body to autopsy since the remains are cremated. There are no witnesses except perpetrators. There are no publicly accessible records. There's no crime scene since operating rooms are cleaned up after every operation. In order for Kilgore and I to come to the conclusion we did, we followed many evidentiary trails which we posited might either prove or disprove the allegations. We came to the conclusion we did by assessing all the evidence from these many trails. It was not one smoking gun which led to the conclusion we formed, but rather all the evidence. While we believe the conclusion is correct, convincing a skeptic is not a quick fix. It takes time. Now, let me mention to you just some of these evidentiary trails. One of the things we did, for instance, is we had callers calling in to China, pretending to be relatives of patients who needed transplants, asking hospitals if they had organs of Falun Gong practitioners for sale. And so we got, in about 15% of the calls, admissions on tape saying, yes, we have them for sale. And we have tapes, and we have transcripts, and we have translations. And we got these admissions throughout China. So that was one bit of evidence. Another bit of evidence is we looked at the numbers, the volumes of transplants compared to the identifiable sources. The Chinese government, when we started, said everything was coming from donations, even though they had no donation system. They subsequently shifted to saying everything is coming from prisoners sentenced to death and then executed, but they don't release death penalty statistics. However, in order to supply the volume of transplants which are going on in China, they would have to be executing people in the tens of thousands. And there's nothing, although there's a very high execution rate in China, and no one estimates it's that high. So that was another evidentiary trail. A third trail was blood tests. We interviewed a number of people who got out of China, out of the prisons and out of China, the country, and what they told us, Falun Gong practitioners, non-Falun Gong alike, was that the Falun Gong practitioners were being systematically blood tested and organ examined, and the non-Falun Gong practitioners were not. Now, it wasn't being done for their health because they were being tortured, but it is necessary for transplants because you need blood type compatibility for transplants. And the people who we found this out from, I mean, they didn't appreciate the significance of it, and it wasn't really of much concern to them. They weren't told why it was being done, but we found this as a consistent pattern. So, and there's many more trails like that, but the point is, what we did is we got an awful lot of evidence, and this is, of course, a very lawyerly thing to do, looked at all the evidence, both for and against, and came to an assessment based on all the evidence. And that's, of course, not as simple, as easy, or as obvious to communicate, or as quick to communicate, as saying, here is this very clear violation. So, I mean, these are a couple of the strategic problems, I suppose you could say, we faced in dealing with this issue. Yet, in retrospect, because we have been doing this now since 2006 for 5 years, it's my view that advocating the end to the abuse of the killing of Falun Gong for their organs is not just a right choice, but also a strategic choice. And I would say from experience, if you want to pull at one thread of the quilt of human rights violations in China in order to unravel the whole quilt, I would suggest pull on this thread. Now, why is that so? Let me give you a number of reasons. One is that, first of all, the best choice when you're talking about human rights violations is to go after the worst violations, rather than the ones most easily amenable to change. The notion that you would go after minor violations and put the worst ones aside is Machiavellian. It kind of steps outside of principle. I mean, the principle choice is to go after the worst violations. And as a human rights advocate, you want to be as principled as possible. So that's one reason. A second reason is think of the audience. Now, of course, when you're dealing with a perpetrator, very often, I mean, it's not just China. I would say most perpetrators are oblivious or unconcerned or turned a blind eye or a deaf ear to claims of violations. And your primary audience is not the violator, it's the victim. And your secondary audience also is not the perpetrator, it's the public at large. And obviously, for the victims, this sort of violation is going to matter more to them. I mean, violations where people are killed is going to matter more to them than violations where people survive. And violations of the most heavily victimized group is going to matter because there are more victims than violations of a group that's less heavily victimized. The Falun Gong are by far the most victimized group in China. According to the UN Rapporteur on Torture, they represent two-thirds of the torture victims in China, and the next largest group are the Uyghurs, they're at 11%, and everybody else is single digit. They are, as well, by far the largest group in arbitrary detention in the re-education through labor camps. Again, from the United States Department of State, they represent about half of the people in re-education through labor camps, and no other group is nowhere close. So if you want to think strategically about doing something that relates to the concerns of the victims, this very much relates to this concern. An example, this wasn't just our choice. There's at least one other human rights advocate I can point to that Jerry Cohen is very familiar with, Gao Jisheng, who's made the same choice. Gao Jisheng is a Chinese human rights lawyer. I mean, he's a human rights lawyer like David Kilgore and I are, except he's working in China, David Kilgore and I are working in Canada. David Kilgore and I are not Falun Gong practitioners, neither is Gao Jisheng, but he came to the same conclusion we did. If you want to really get at the problem of human rights in China, go after the victimization of Falun Gong. And he has become the symbol of resistance to human rights in China. And, well, I could go on quite a bit about him, but as I'm sure Jerry Cohen could. But the point is that this is a choice that makes sense and others have made. I would also say that what we're trying to do is communicate an issue to the public at large. And by going through this issue about who the Falun Gong are, it gets us into the problem of organ transplant abuse, it gets us into the problem of torture, it gets us into the problem of religious intolerance, it gets us into the problem of re-education through labor camps. It's an entry into a wide array of human rights violations in China. I mean, how do we end the abuse, supposing we identified it? Well, end the persecution of Falun Gong, which gets us into that issue. I mean, if you end the persecution of Falun Gong, you end the killing of Falun Gong for their organs. Shut down the re-education through labor camps. I mean, all the people who are killed for their organs are in arbitrary detention. Stop the arbitrary detention, you stop this problem. Stop the killing of prisoners for their organs. The Chinese government admits it's killing prisoners for their organs, and acknowledges it's wrong, and it just says that the prisoners are all prisoners sentenced to death and then executed, and denies that they're Falun Gong. But if you stop the killing of Falun Gong, of prisoners for their organs, then you stop the killing of Falun Gong prisoners for their organs without the need to establish which prisoners are being killed for their organs. So there's, it's a way of getting into the issue. Okay, it has a strategic value for the victims. It has a strategic value for the public. But I would say, finally, that it does have a strategic value in dealing with the perpetrators. And you know, David Kilgore and I have been on this issue for 5 years now. So we've got some experience, and we can say that from experience, it has had an impact. I mean, sure, we've had this Chinese propaganda, which is silly, which is vicious, which doesn't, which responds in such a way that it's just propaganda. They're not paying attention, and all that is true. But at the same time, as they're talking nonsense, they're acting on the ground in a way that is at least moving the yardsticks. They've shut down many of the websites we cited, which obviously doesn't help very much. But some of the other things they've done is that they have set up a registration system for hospitals for transplants. Before, when we got started, any hospital in China that wanted to do transplants could do so. And now only hospitals registered with the health system can do transplants. They secondly have not completely, but almost completely stopped transplant tourism. When we started, the bulk of the transplants were being bought by foreign patients and being paid for in foreign currency. And the Chinese hospitals were filled with these foreign patients, mostly from neighboring countries, Taiwan and South Korea and Japan and Indonesia and so on. Although there have been some from the U.S. and Canada, and anybody could go, and lots went, because there's an organ shortage everywhere. The Chinese government said they were going to give priority, after our report came out, they were going to give priority to Chinese patients, and really started to enforce that. As a result, transplant tourism has gone way down. Thirdly, they've actually started a donation system in China. It just started last year in 10 cities as a pilot project and hasn't generated many donations yet, but at least it started. Fourthly, they have promised to enact a law allowing for organ sourcing from the brain dead, cardiac alive, the accident victims. It's not a law now, and it should have been a law a while ago, but at least they have... said they would do it. They've also, as I've mentioned to you before, they've acknowledged that organs are coming from prisoners. It's not quite the acknowledgement that we wanted, but at least they've moved from the position that organs are coming from donations. They have also acknowledged, since we did our report, that sourcing of organs from prisoners is wrong. An important shift in their position. So what we can see is a lot of movement. At the same time as the talk about the Falun Gong and the talk about our report is total rejection, there's a lot of movement in the field which is dealing with the issue. I wouldn't say the problem is solved, because as far as we can tell, they're still sourcing organs from Falun Gong practitioners in large numbers. But at least they're reacting in such a way as to try to cut down on the criticism which our report has generated. So I would say that strategically, it has made sense to do what we would do, what we have done, and I would, of course, encourage others to join us in that effort. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. For the final of the opening statements, Colin Gillespie on the asylum applications of Falun Gong practitioners in the United States.
Right, so I'll start by thanking Professor Estreicher for having me on this panel and acknowledging my co-panelists, as I think is fairly clear I'm the junior member of a panel which includes Professor Cohen and Mr. Matus, both of whom have been working on human rights issues and generally and in China for more years than I have been alive. It's a very real privilege to be on this dais right now.
Now you're rubbing it in.
I said that at the risk of being indelicate.
Remember, I said you were 50, Jerry.
I thought 60.
So given the discrepancy in expertise, where I might add some value in what Professor Estreicher has asked me to talk about is the fate of Falun Gong in the U.S. asylum process. That's also an opportunity, I think, to make good on what Professor Cohen asked us all to do, which is to look inwardly at our own human rights commitments while also looking outwardly at the situation of human rights in China, to the extent that you believe that the asylum process is a way for the United States to make good on its human rights commitments. So that's what I'll be talking about, the fate of Falun Gong and U.S. asylum petitions for 10 minutes. So at this point, there have been more than 650 asylum eligibility applications by Falun Gong practitioners decided at the level of the courts of appeals since 2003. That contrasts with about two dozen cases of Falun Gong asylum applications in 2005. I looked at those in order to determine what sorts of patterns were emerging in Falun Gong asylum applications, and I've read the last 150 decisions in the courts of appeals on Falun Gong asylum applications. So what follows are conclusions that are provisional. They're provisional in two senses. The first is that they don't encompass all of the Falun Gong asylum applications that have been made in the courts of appeals or decided in the courts of appeals, and second, they only represent Falun Gong asylum applications petitions at one level of the asylum-making decision process, namely the courts of appeals, not the Board of Immigration Appeals or immigration judges or individual asylum officers. So I'll do three things. The first is to briefly supplement what Mr. Matus described as the situation of the Falun Gong in China. The second will be to briefly lay out U.S. asylum procedures, and third, to kind of share some of the patterns that are emerging with respect to Falun Gong asylum applications, at least based on decisions in the courts of appeal. So those two, what is happening will focus generally on definitions of religious persecution and their application to Falun Gong practitioners, and then adverse credibility determinations, which are a major hurdle for Falun Gong practitioners in the asylum process. So we've heard who the Falun Gong are, generally speaking. I think it's important just to supplement what Mr. Matus said with a few numbers. This statement has appeared in every State Department human rights report since 2006. Falun Gong sources estimated that since 1999, at least 6,000 Falun Gong practitioners had been sentenced to prison. More than 100,000 practitioners had been sentenced to re-education through labor camps, and almost 3,000 had died from torture while in custody. The State Department has repeated those figures every year, and the treatment of the Falun Gong by the Chinese government has variously been described as a crackdown, repression, and a severe campaign. The source, the State Department, is incredibly important with respect to individual asylum application adjudications. There are two more points that I think are worth underscoring. The Chinese government doesn't dispute elements of persecution, at least with respect to incarceration rates, and its official policy of banning the Falun Gong practice in China. And second, the courts of appeals that have passed on the issue have not disputed as a factual matter the findings in the State Department reports. So the U.S. asylum process. There are five categories in which a refugee can qualify for asylum. If they've been persecuted on account of race or ethnicity, which isn't relevant here, or on the grounds of political opinion, membership in a particular social group or religion. I'll just be focusing on religious persecution, most relevant in the Falun Gong context. If the applicant has suffered past persecution on account of one of those statutorily defined grounds, or if the applicant has a well-founded fear of suffering from persecution on one of those statutorily defined grounds, then that applicant will be eligible for asylum. So where are Falun Gong applications falling short in determining eligibility for asylum applications? For asylum eligibility, rather. The first area is religious persecution. So what is the evidence of inconsistent application of asylum law with respect to Falun Gong applications? Religious persecution generally, is not defined in the statute which governs asylum applications, nor has it been defined in the regulations which govern asylum adjudicating institutions in the United States. What is persecution on account of religion? At least three courts of appeals have held, and two in context specific to Falun Gong, that outlawing a religion and hence forcing adherents of the religion to practice in secret is a form of religious persecution. No appellate court, it should be noted, has taken a contrary position on the definition of religious persecution. What are these cases? In Muhur v. Ashcroft, Judge Posner reasoned that the immigration judge made a fatal assumption, quote, a clear error of law, that one is not entitled to claim asylum on the basis of religious persecution if one can escape notice of the persecutors by concealing one's religion. That case dealt with an Eritrean Jehovah's Witness who was afraid of being persecuted if they were returned to Eritrea. That's notable because being a Jehovah's Witness was not illegal in Eritrea at the time. It was merely a discriminated against characteristic. So Judge Posner relied on Muhur and Yao v. Gonzalez, the case of a Falun Gong practitioner seeking asylum, for the proposition that being forced to practice one's religion in secret was in no wise inconsistent with having a well-founded fear of persecution. Seventh Circuit later affirmed that asylum exists to protect people from having to return to a country and conceal their beliefs. So Yao v. Gonzalez, big deal. Similarly, in 2004, the Ninth Circuit held that to require a Falun Gong petitioner to practice his beliefs in secret is contrary to our basic principles of religious freedom and the protection of religious refugees. In Zhang, the applicant had testified to his knowledge of Falun Gong. He had missed the deadline for an asylum application, and so he had to demonstrate not only that he would be subject to, that he had a well-founded fear of persecution, rather, but that it was more probable than not that the applicant would be subject to religious persecution on return to China. The court concluded that not only had the individual shown a clear probability of, had shown a clear probability of persecution on account of his spiritual or religious beliefs, that's a higher standard than merely satisfying eligibility for asylum. I'll skip ahead. So how has this principle been applied in the case of Falun Gong practitioners applying for asylum? The short answer is that it's been applied inconsistently. What's the evidence of that? With respect to past persecution, Falun Gong practitioners who have been sought after by the Chinese police on the grounds of their beliefs, detained for questioning because of their religious beliefs, or detained and beaten due to their religious practices or beliefs, have been declared ineligible for asylum. That's those because they haven't suffered from religious persecution. Those are inexplicable decisions. It should follow that if religious persecution includes being forced to practice one's religion underground, then it's certainly religious persecution if one has been arrested or beaten for not having effectively concealed one's religious beliefs. I'll just say there are no countervailing considerations which might counsel against that sort of finding in the case of a Falun Gong practitioner. It's a nonviolent religion. They haven't been accused, to the extent that I'm aware, of advocating for violence against the Chinese state. What's the second major problem for Falun Gong asylum applicants in the context of determining eligibility for asylum? That's the problem of adverse credibility. So that's not a particularly surprising result. Adverse credibility determinations are the most common reason for rejecting asylum applications across the spectrum of applicants, religious persecution or political persecution and so forth. Adverse credibility findings in the case of Falun Gong applicants are based on a number of factors, including the applicant changing his testimony over the course of an asylum adjudication, changing the years in which he or she purported to practice Falun Gong, or internal inconsistencies in documents prepared or produced in the course of asylum proceedings. I don't want to question these individual adverse credibility determinations. They're determinations, quite obviously, of fact and not of law. I will note the systemic problems with credibility determinations in the context of Falun Gong that have been articulated by Judge Posner, and note how they still implicate Falun Gong asylum applications. So There's evidence that the unwillingness of some immigration judges to find past persecution is related to the inability to fully conceptualize a religion that has adherents and practitioners, but no formal qualifications for membership. Perhaps that, yeah. In Yao versus Gonzalez, Judge Posner noted six disturbing features of the handling of this case that bulk large in the immigration cases that we are seeing, specific with respect to the Falun Gong, over his finding that there is, at the level of the fact finder, a lack of familiarity with relevant foreign cultures and an exaggerated notion of how much religious people know about their religion. With respect to the first, Posner reasoned that Falun Gong is not theistic, nor is it hierarchical. So far as it appears, what is central is neither doctrine nor symbol, but exercises, as Mr. Matus noted. It is clear, however, from the case that I surveyed, that there's evidence that fact finders are relying on applicants' lack of doctrinal knowledge to conclude that the applicant is not, in fact, a genuine Falun Gong practitioner. One immigration judge made an adverse credibility determination on the ground that, given the applicant's description of the literature that he gave to his coworkers, he could not have expected to persuade them that Falun Gong was not an evil cult. Posner also noted that Falun Gong does not have any formal qualifications for membership, right? So the fluidity in Falun Gong adherence or membership appears to be troubling to some judges when determining whether or not Falun Gong have been subject to past persecution. The underlying assumption seems to be that Falun Gong practitioners could have been able to escape detention or modified their practices to avoid persecution. What's incredible to the fact finder, in other words, often seems to be not the applicant, but the practice itself. So I'll just, with respect specifically to Falun Gong asylum applications, I'll conclude with Judge Posner again. Anyone, we suppose, can get hold of a book of Li Hongzhi's teachings, start doing the exercises, and truthfully declare himself or herself a bona fide adherent of Falun Gong. The implications for potential Chinese immigration to the United States may be significant. The United States has every right to control immigration, but Congress has not authorized the immigration services to do so by denying asylum applications in unreasoned decisions. So the hope is for, of course, a return to reason and a return to a definition of religious persecution, which includes being forced to practice one's religion underground as a element of persecution.
Thank you.
Thanks, Professor.
Thank you, Colin. Terrific job. I commend all of you to Colin's paper. Copies are available in the front here, and I believe also outside. You've all been a very good audience. I want to give you a chance to make comments or ask questions. So do we have a traveling mic, Tori? Excellent. All right, I see one on the side there. You guys can even wait online if you'd like. It might be easier. And would you identify yourselves and tell us who you're directing the question at?
Sure. First of all, thank you to all the panelists. This has been extremely interesting. My name is Gabriel Hopkins. I'm a 1L here at NYU. I have a question. I suppose I'll direct it towards both Colin and Professor Cohen. In a lot of the kind of color revolutions that we've been seeing around the world for the past 7 or 8 years, there's been a lot of talk about the sort of power that young people and sort of the internet have played in a lot of these political movements. We've seen that also very vividly in a lot of things happening in the Middle East. But here in China, I get a lot of sense that young people and the internet actually are, there's been a lot of zealous nationalism, a lot of conservatism coming from those fields. So I'm curious if either of you have some comments about how those two sort of fields play, or how human rights and sort of this countervailing force of nationalism are playing out amongst young people and on the internet in the context of China.
Want to take that, Jerry?
Yeah, there's an article out today by Associated Press stating that one of the groups that has launched the idea into China from outside of having a Jasmine Revolution in China is composed of young people in their 20s who are scattered, some here, some in South Korea, some in five or six other countries. And apparently they're other groups, four or five perhaps. These are young people. They're not captured by what Gabriel rightly points out is a rising tide of nationalism in people under 40 in China. That's frightened a lot of my Chinese friends who are over 40 because they see they're dealing with a problem they never had before. So young people have all kinds of ideas. In China, it's clear that students at Peking University, which is the traditional heart of new ideas, fresh thinking, challenging governments over the decades, they have their own ideas. That's why they've just established these committees to help students who show independent thinking. There is a problem all over China now that goes beyond normal policing, that's trying to engage in prevention, and whether their police being told in their street work to look out for people who have independent thoughts, or whether their university people, like at Peking University, the party is scared of independent thinking, and there are just lots of young people in China who have retained independent thoughts, but they're understandably opportunistic enough to keep quiet, because it's obvious what happens. You know the old saying in East Asia, not just in China, the nail that stands up gets hammered. And I think you quote in your book the modification of that that says, to those who have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And that's what's happening in China today.
I think David has a comment on this.
Yes. I didn't really talk about the internet in my introductory remarks, but again, I've had to deal with a lot in this particular issue. When the Falun Gong was banned, this was one of the reasons that Jiang Zemin gave for banning them. I mean, at the time the Falun Gong was banned, they were very popular and they were throughout the whole system, and there was a lot of leakages. So we actually got the memo that Jiang Zemin sent to the Central Committee of the Communist Party asking for the banning of Falun Gong, and this is part of what he wrote, that the rapid development of information technology poses new subjects of studies. Our various departments have many computers. Has anyone noticed these new social trends? If yes, why isn't it reported to us? These issues require careful study. Now, what he was referring to was the gathering in Beijing of a group of Falun Gong protesters in April in 1999, which Jiang Zemin was telling the Central Committee that the party hadn't anticipated, and the police hadn't anticipated, and he was worried about it. So you can see that there's, just from this one memo, that there's kind of like a cat and mouse game between the Chinese state and the opposition dealing with the internet. Now, I mean, my general theme was that strategically, dealing with the Falun Gong is a wise choice in dealing with human rights violations, and this is one facet of that strategic choice, which I didn't mention, which is the Falun Gong, even though it is a set of exercises which anybody can do, has a number of organizations of practitioners associated with it that have been quite effective in dealing with Chinese human rights violations generally. NTD TV, New Tang Dynasty TV, the Epoch Times newspaper, Sound of Hope radio, and there's been a lot of internet effort to try to penetrate into China, to try to break through the Chinese wall of censorship. There's a lot of course Chinese government censorship of the internet, and you can't actually even use the words Falun Gong in China on the internet without it being picked up by the internet police. And I myself have been threatened by the internet police, and there's lots of funny things going on. But as I say, there's been a lot of efforts within the Falun Gong community to overcome that in order to get information into China about what's going on in China. And that technology actually was used in Iran at the time of the demonstrations after the faked election where Ahmadinejad got sort of re-elected president even though he lost the vote. against Mousavi, and there were demonstrations that were organized by breaking through the Iranian internet firewall using the technology that Falun Gong had developed, to the point where the Chinese government and Iranian government started cooperating and trying to develop firewall technology. So the point is that this is happening in China, and it is part of. It's just that the Chinese government is making every effort to try to stop it as well.
Sir, come forward.
Thank you very much, panelists. My name is Charles Lee. I'm the spokesperson for the Global Service Center for Quitting the Communist Party. Communist Party. Service Center for Quitting the CCP.
Quitting the CCP?
Exactly, which means the Chinese Communist Party. And also, I'm a Falun Gong practitioner.
Quitting membership or having China?
Membership of the Communist Party and also the Communist Youth League and also
Communist
Young Pioneer Group. So that's like, we call that three quitting. I'm also a Falun Gong practitioner, and also I was a victim of the persecution myself. I was in prison for 3 years in China by the communist. I want to make some comments over here because Professor Cohen mentioned the China's economy has made a big progress in the last 30 years. I want to point out that the biggest economic miracle was made by Nazi Germany. And the Nazi Germany, they had the biggest economic miracle in human history.
I hate to do this to you, but ask a question, give us a, I respect you, but we don't want speechifying. So give us a question or...
Yeah, I want to just see, because none of the panelists mentioned about the biggest human rights movement in China right now is the quitting the Communist Party membership. Really? Right now, there are over 90 million people inside China who have quit.
How do people manifest that they're quitting the Communist Party?
They send out their announcement through internet and through all different channels to outside of the world. So that is the a thing that unnoticed by a lot of people in this country, and I want to just mention that this is important phenomenon in China, and it will change China, and also will change the world because anything happens in China is big and huge. It will impact this this world. So we have seen this in the economy. Actually, I want to just finish my comments on the economy in China. It has not benefited the majority of the Chinese people, and we will not benefit the Chinese people in the majority. So, and I don't think that's a normal economy, and that will not bring any good for the human society as a whole. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So,
you want to?
Let me. It sounds to me like there was a question there, and the question was, why didn't we mention this? I guess
what's this, David?
The quitting the Communist Party is a way of ending human rights violations of China, my answer, well, partly is we only have so much time. There's only so much we can say, but now that you do raise it, I think it is worth mentioning because how do we end human rights violations in China, which is the overall question. I think one way of doing it is just getting people to stop adhering to, believing in, supporting the Communist Party. If nobody believes that believes that the Communist Party should be in charge, then it won't be in charge. So picking away at its support, I think is certainly a strategic
David,
way.
David, aren't they so closely? The Communist Party, no one believes in the Communist Party anymore, I believe. But it's the ticket to success, material success, political influence. I mean, most people are not heroic. And so this is the path of least resistance. My impression from talking, I was just there 2 weeks, the faculty are all communists. Are they believing communists? No. Many of the grad students in Jerry Cohen's program are members of the party. But it's just because it's a ticket, it's something you have to do to make a career in China. So I just don't think it's going to happen a lot. I admire the people doing it, but I just don't see it as a way for change.
I think what was said is fascinating because it sounds like this organization is a kind of Communist Party equivalent of Alcoholics Anonymous or something. And it's a great idea. I don't know about it. It'd be worth studying how they operate and how they sustain people who have decided to quit the party. I do want to mention ideology. I don't think we should underestimate, because the people we have contact with tend not to believe in the party, that there aren't millions of people who still believe in the party. Some of them naive, some of them uneducated, simple. A lot of people just believe in Beijing and the party center, even if they don't like what they know in their daily reality in their localities. And there are often, of course, people who believe China couldn't hold together without the party, because they've created a situation that we see in Libya and lots of other countries that are struggling with what kind of government to have, where there's no alternative except perhaps the military in many of these countries. So if you frustrate the growth of NGOs and you frustrate the growth of other parties that might take over, the party becomes the only alternative, and some people believe in it. One other factor is, it is true, people in China, many of them, feel the need for some faith. They want to believe in something, and the party makes them rather cynical often. A lot of the human rights activists are Christian, whether Protestant or Catholic. Gao Zhisheng, whom you've mentioned a few times, is motivated in part by Christian ideology, and a number of the other rights lawyers and rights activists whom I have met are Christian. I think some of them are truly devout. Others may do it because it gets them a free trip to the United States occasionally or other benefits. But we all do things for a range of motives, but we shouldn't ignore the impact of tens of millions of Protestants in China, as well as a lesser number of Catholics.
Well, there's no question that the Chinese state sees these various alternative belief systems as a threat. And I think they'd be wise to start viewing themselves as a modernizing elite. They're no longer an ideological party. And it might open up avenues for some of this alternative, you know, faith systems that can coexist
the Chinese
with monopoly of political power by the state. I think there's a trap here. I don't think they believe it any longer as a belief system. It may be a system that rewards people, and it's a source of stability. I don't deny any of that.
I think there are advanced thinkers in the party school, the Central Party School in Beijing, who are looking to the day when the party will have to run for office in a serious way.
I wasn't making a claim for democracy. They could be an authoritarian modernizing elite, Jerry, still maintain power for the next 40 years.
Exactly.
Which is a long period of time in the history of man. And let people, I'm not a Falun Gong practitioner. What bothers me about this is they're not militant, they don't have guns, they're not in the middle of a civil war, and they're being hounded by the state. It's the purest human rights problem on earth, if I can say so. There's no ambiguity about it. They're being hounded. We have Catholics who have to, can you believe this? I mean, I know that most of us are not believers any longer in the church or a deity, but they're not allowed to have their own priests. They have to have priests picked for them by the state. Now, here's our leading competitor. You know, we do business with them. We should be raising the voices on these issues. We'll have a program next year on labor, the same thing. People can't get together to talk about their grievances. In a modern state that's our major competitor, we have transferred our entire production capability to the Chinese. We should be insisting on civilized behavior from them. This is not a threat to their regime. Do not buy into their ideology. They can still control power, in my view, with flourishing Catholicism, flourishing Protestantism. I've never heard of Protestantism as a threat in the last 400 years. And flourishing Falun Gong. They can retain control of political power for the next 40 years. It's not a threat to them. We ought to be selling it to them and insisting upon it, insisting upon that vision. Anyway, that was my comment.
Hi, my name is Matt Robertson. I'm with the Epoch Times newspaper.
You're with the?
The Epoch Times newspaper.
Okay.
Journalist. So just a question to Jerry, I believe. It's about Ai Weiwei and the Global Times response. So an editorial came out called "Law Will Not Concede Before Maverick" by the Global Times in English and Chinese. And one part says, Ai Weiwei chooses to have a different attitude from ordinary people toward law. However, the law will not concede before mavericks just because of the Western media's criticism. So I'm curious about sort of, is this the official Party Central speaking to the West? And why would they take this tack? And what can we expect is going to happen to Ai Weiwei? Any predictions?
Right now, we haven't got much to go on in trying to analyze what's the reason for Ai Weiwei's detention and what's his likely fate. But the article you mentioned, which came out in English and Chinese in the Global Times, which is a kind of advanced spokesperson for the People's Daily Group, it's not necessarily representative of the regime, but it gives you some insight into what some important elements in the party think, especially the more nationalistic elements. I think they're saying that Ai Weiwei can't impose his personal preferences on the state of China, that no individual has the right to do that. They're going to now try to brand him as an ordinary economic criminal, not a human rights person, in order to diminish his stature. But we don't know much more than that. It's hard to make too much of what's appeared so far. But you're right to call our attention to that article. I have some more things I wanted to say about David's interesting remarks and book, but maybe we should
let's take a few people. Yeah. We'll come back to you.
Hi, I need to lower the mic. My name is Sarah Cook. I'm an Asia researcher, and actually I study internet freedom with Freedom House. And I wanted to go back to one of the first issues that Jerry raised, but regarding this question of a sense sometimes of the inevitability of repression, and I think that there's, particularly on issues like Falun Gong, there's a sense, whether it's from the outside of what do we do about this, or for people inside China, of whether they should stand up and stick their necks out for people like this who are suffering from these kinds of abuses. And I guess I just wanted to maybe prod the panel a bit more on what could we really do. We had a long discussion internally today about what press release do we issue related to this trend, not just of Ai Weiwei's disappearance, Gao Zhisheng being gone for like almost a year, and even his wife doesn't know where he is, about 28 other people who have been disappeared. And you know, for us as an international human rights organization, you know, what recommendation do we make to the US government? What can we do in terms of our voice when there's a sense that you know, in a lot of ways the CCP isn't listening? We settled on asking Assistant Secretary of State Campbell to actually ask to meet with Ai Weiwei and some of the activists. So I would be curious to see what your thoughts are on that particular strategy. And really just more generally, both I think for people working inside China on how do you deal with an issue in generally, but also just with an issue like Falun Gong, where there's a sense of kind of inevitable pushback or inevitable backlash, and a situation where it's almost like the Communist Party can't back out of it at this point because of all of the propaganda. I mean, for the Communist Party tomorrow to declare that Falun Gong is all of a sudden permitted just like undermines their legitimacy on so many levels. So I guess I wanted to just prod that a bit more because it's something that we face in our work pretty much on a daily basis.
Well,
thank you.
That enables me to make one of the points
good
I wanted to make, which is this book, Mr. Mattis and his colleague, Mr. Kilger, have done, of course, focuses on the controversy that he discussed. But as the book also suggests, we shouldn't allow the controversial nature of this organ charge to distract from the broader questions of the extent to which the Falun Gong has been peculiarly punished. One of the many interesting things in this book, I felt, was the extent to which they show why it's the Falun Gong that gets particularly the ire of the regime. And they have a whole laundry list of at least a dozen factors that are interesting. The most interesting to me, by the way, was it says Falun Gong comes out of the Chinese soil. It's an autochthonous Chinese product. Communism is a foreign import into China. And we often t- tend to forget that. But when you ask what should be done in terms of practical measures, another thing I got out of this book, because as they say, it doesn't matter whether you believe us or not on the organ charge, but here are the 20 things that we on the outside should be doing. And it's a very powerful, well-argued list. Most of the things haven't been tried yet. And I like that. And number 20 made me pause a bit, as I said earlier in the day to Mr. Mattis, because it says we should stop the regular international human rights dialogue with China. Many governments try to make up for the inability to do much about China by having these bilateral dialogues. We're going to have another one with China soon. I think much of it is just hokum, and I've been trying to suggest to our government a number of ways to make these dialogues more meaningful. But read his list of 20 things that we ought to be trying. I thought it was...
What are some of them, David?
Yeah, why don't you tell us?
Read the book.
We know the 20... Well, give us a little tease.
Let me talk about number 20, about ending a dialogue. Now, that comes out of a history. The history was that Canada and others at the UN Human Rights Commission were introducing resolutions about human rights in China. And China didn't like, I mean, the resolutions never passed, but China didn't like the very fact that they were being presented. It started procedural motions about no discussion and so on, but then it started this bilateral dialogues, and they basically offered the governments a quid pro quo. Don't introduce the resolutions, instead we'll meet and have human rights dialogues. And in retrospect, my view is that was a bad deal. I wouldn't say don't ever talk with China at all about human rights dialogues, but don't trade away publicly raising condemnation of Chinese human rights violations against the promise of a dialogue. That's a bad deal. In answer to Sarah's question, I don't think that there's any one magic bullet, one strategic choice that's going to completely solve everything. And in a general sort of way, I would say try everything all the time, everywhere, because it's the constant pressure. I mean, that's what you're dealing with the Chinese government. The Chinese government repression is not just in China; it's global. I mean, they are propagandizing against the Falun Gong everywhere. They're trying to shut down audiences and events everywhere. They're using intimidation everywhere. It's a global force of propaganda and human rights repression. Now, of course, they're arming repressive regimes and cooperating with repressive regimes. And it's the variety of pressures that I think have a cumulative effect, which is greater than any one of them. As our own experience has shown, that I mean, you can try one thing with them that'll have no impact on them visibly in that one exchange, but they react in another way, so that they can say they're ignoring you, and verbally they seem to be ignoring you, but then they will do something somewhere else to do it. One has to think of the party as a vehicle for trying to keep the people in place in power, I think Sam Estreicher is right to that extent. But one component of that is the ideology, which some people at least believe, and certainly Jerry Cohen is right about that. There are many people who do believe it, and if nobody believed it, I think the whole system would just collapse. So they need the believers, and the various things they do can all be explained by this attempt to maintain the party in power. Falun Gong was repressed. I mean, they've got lots of reasons why they say they don't like the Falun Gong, but what really bothered them was that it was popular and it was a non-communist. What we have to do is react to that dynamic. Some things, eventually, some human rights violations, which may be there to try to keep them in power, at some point become so embarrassing that it works against them. And if something is so embarrassing that it works against them, then they move. And even with Gao Jisheng, I mean, he's been treated horribly. But at some point when the protests against him reached the pinnacle, they coughed him up for a few days. He said he was all right in a very, although he was audibly in bad shape, and then he disappeared again. And so I think we have to think about it as right. as putting the overall strategy has to be putting such pressure on them that they move away from the particular sure. violation because it hurts more their strategy of staying in power than it helps.
Sir.
David Law, Professor of Law, Political Science, Washington University in St. Louis, visiting scholar, NYU Law School. I have a question for Professor Cohen. I think partly for Professor Estreicher, and also a question for Colin Gillespie. I'm sorry I haven't got one directly from my fellow Canadian, Mr. Matus, but perhaps there's something in here that will engage him. Jerry, you know, the question with the hardliners, you mentioned that there are progressive thinkers in the party school who foresee a time when the Communist Party will have to compete seriously for office. And my question is, what are the hardliners thinking? Are they thinking that this regime is indefinitely sustainable? And if so, what are the assumptions they're making on which that projection rests? And that ties into my question for Professor Estreicher. This idea that the regime will continue for 40 years, I could see that happening, but it seems to me that that's going to rest on some assumptions, right? One, and these may be, any one of these may be by itself sufficient, I don't know, but one would be continued economic growth in China, right? You buy the complicity of the population, or at least you buy them off enough that they're not willing or able to rise up. But our local economist slash magician slash soothsayer, Mr. Rubini, I believe, has already projected the economic miracle in China is not going to sustain itself for 40 years. So are we resting on this idea that the regime can survive? Does it rest on a perhaps faulty assumption that there will be continued prosperity in China? Beyond that, it seems that people who want to change the regime, they face an information problem and a coordination problem. And to what extent can you keep the Chinese population ignorant, relying on this great firewall of China? Mr. Matus, and maybe this is where this engages him, has described some of the mechanisms, these are very interesting, that Falun Gong is using to penetrate the great firewall. And it seems to me increasingly likely that it's going to be increasingly difficult for the regime to keep that kind of information out and to prevent the Chinese citizens from using the same kinds of coordination mechanisms that have worked in Egypt and are working, seem to be working elsewhere in the Middle East. And finally, for Colin, on the question of adjudication in asylum adjudication, I wasn't totally clear to me from your paper the extent to which you think that these disagreements among the circuits and the unwillingness to grant asylum rests on sincere disagreements over whether the treatment of Falun Gong qualifies as persecution, or over sincere factual disagreements over how the Falun Gong practitioners are being treated. And I would say my skepticism is informed by the empirical scholarship on asylum adjudication, the courts of appeals. If you want to look for an area where judicial ideology is driving decision-making, it's asylum, right? On the Ninth Circuit, Republican-dominated panels vote in favor of the asylum claimant 10% of the time. Democratic panels do so 50% of the time. So is it possible that we're taking fact and law too seriously, or am I imputing something to you that you're not actually doing? Thanks.
Why don't we take Collins first? It's narrower. And I have a question for Colin, too. We're going to come back. Professor Law, thank you for those great questions.
Yeah, thank you.
You can think of your answer while we're doing this. Are you taking fact and law too seriously?
Right. So the point is obviously well taken. Ideology is what's driving empirically most asylum adjudications. I mean, the idea with respect to Falun Gong is specific to one finding, which is that the idea about religious persecution being forced, encompassing an idea about being forced to practice one's religion in secret is an idea that has currency in at least three circuits and has never been refuted by other circuits. The question then is, well, what's happening in the rest of the cases where Falun Gong are being returned to China or found not eligible for asylum? I mean, I don't think, I'm right, again, with youth, perhaps I'm so naive that I believe that the law actually matters in these cases, but, you know, I mean, the fact, I do think, though, as a matter perhaps of political valence or ideology, that the idea that it's not persecution to be forced to a choice to practice one's religion in secret or face imprisonment, torture, and so forth. I don't necessarily consider that to be ideologically divisive question. I think that that would be an area where there would you would find, you know, agreement across the political divide.
I think we in the academy have taken legal realism and made it a disease. These cases get adjudicated a certain way, and you know they're uncounseled initially with the immigration judge. The immigration judge makes certain determinations, and most court of appeals panels just go along with the BIA and the IJ, I think. And I don't think it's a disagreement. Well, we'll go over that together. There are some hard cases I don't deny where a political disposition may control, but in most cases it's this basic attitude they're getting at the lower court levels, at the lower levels of the adjudicative process. And so there's a view of Falun Gong, maybe because of the size of the docket that will emerge, but there's a view, and I think the State Department is temporized here. I think a clearer statement from the State Department would help a great deal here.
It would be helpful if we had a clear statement about that and about the Ai Weiwei situation from our president and our Secretary of State instead of a mere spokesman for the State Department. I think in the UK, the situation may be worse in considering who is eligible for asylum. I'm involved in a case there now that may help improve the situation. But the standard rule in the UK, and I understand that's followed in the European community, is that it's all right to send Falun Gong people back to China because as long as they just practice quietly and they don't organize, they'll be all right. But the case I'm involved in, it shows how blurred that line can get. This is a youngish man who had a discussion group in his small rural town. About five people would meet once or twice a week just to talk about life. They had ordinary jobs. They weren't really university graduates. They may have had a year or two at college. And they met at the home of a fellow whose mother must have been flirting with the Falun Gong, and she sent from Beijing some Falun Gong material, including, it must have been the newspaper that goes into the nine ways of viewing the Communist Party's abuses, etc. And he made the mistake of printing out the material and handing it to the other four so they could have something to read and discuss the next time. And one of the four had a brother who was a policeman who saw the material at home. And the policeman turned this fellow in. And he was taken in, beaten so severely that after a few weeks of torture, had to be sent to the hospital in order to make sure he was not going to die. Then they sent him home for further recovery, but they didn't end the case. A couple of weeks later, while he's recovering at home, the policeman who turned him in, the brother of one of his group, came to look at him because the police were supposed to come in very often to watch him. And this man lost control of his emotions. He got a hold of the policeman, grabbed him. They were at the top of a stairway. They both fell down the stairs, and the policeman was badly hurt, became unconscious. This fellow fled and managed, with the help of a former boss who had felt guilty about having to fire him because of his background, got out of China, got to Eastern Europe, finally made it to London. Now, here he is. He's going to be tried if he's sent back, not only because they never finished this investigation of the Falun Gong, he'll also be tried for what he did to the policeman. And he'll also be tried for illegal exit from China. And the administrative tribunal in the UK, which was considering should he be deemed a political refugee, said no, that the case about Falun Gong wasn't serious, and he would just face a regular criminal trial on assaulting a policeman and leaving China. And they're just totally unrealistic about what it means to be suspected of Falun Gong or any kind of group activity where five people sit around and talk with some independent thinking. And so now it's on appeal, and they've asked me to help on that, and I hope we can.
Yeah, I should say that in Winnipeg, I'm a refugee lawyer, and I'm tempted to enter into this discussion, but I'm not going to, and I'm going to try to stick to what I was talking about before here and try to answer your question more directly, at least the first part of the question, which is what are the assumptions on which the hardliners are acting in doing what they're doing? I mean, you speculated on what some of the assumptions might be and suggested that they weren't very rational, and you're asking for some sort of explanation for their behavior. Well, what I would say to that is that fundamentally, when you're dealing with human rights violators, their behavior is irrational. I mean, you cannot give a plausible, rational explanation for murder, for torture, for arbitrary confinement. I mean, when people engage in this sort of behavior, they're basically crazy. They're nuts. They're cruel, they're inhumane, they're committing crimes against humanity. There is an internal logic, but you'd have to get inside the logic of their thinking. I mean, it's not our logic. I don't think we can just sort of pretend they're like us in a different situation and acting the way we would. We would not do what they're doing. I think to try to impose on them some sort of, or speculate that they have some sort of rationality behind this kind of bizarre behavior gives them more credit than they deserve. I think we just have to take their irrational behavior as a factor with which we have to deal.
I think that oversimplifies the actual situation. Let me give you one case I'm quite familiar with. I used to be friendly with the former Prime Minister of Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, very brilliant fellow, a double first at Cambridge, including law. He made Singapore what it is, and it's a very impressive place. But he has this thing about national security. Right. He spent 6 weeks at Harvard in 1968 after the election, and came back and put in a rule in Singapore. Nobody with long hair was going to be allowed into Singapore.
That's one reason I keep my hair short, by the way.
I didn't have this problem. So it was crazy. I talked about it, but he saw long hair as the symbol of dissatisfaction and maybe potential insurrection. Here he had an absolute vice-like grip on the city. There was no reason for him to be insecure, and yet he had this terrific fear of people who were showing independent thought by letting their hair grow. Now, this is the kind of thinking we're seeing in the leaders of China. Of course, the situation is worse than we're allowed to know, but they have acted in such a way as to make any sort of systematic revolt, any sort of independent organization, impossible. And they don't seem to realize they're making the situation worse.
Right.
By not relaxing,
right,
not improving,
exactly,
institutions, not giving people a public outlet.
Right.
And this is going to get worse over time. Someday there may be a leader who will see that it's going to be popular to give voice to all these dissatisfactions and to lift some of the oppression. But I don't see that immediately on the horizon, although the next occasion will be with the 18th Party Congress.
Any comments back there from people standing? Questions? Yes, please.
Good evening. I'm Ben Guthrie of 1L here at the law school. And I have a two-part question for Mr. Matus on the prospect of reducing the sourcing of organ transplants from prisoners, both Falun Gong and other prisoners. Trying not to put my own cultural assumptions onto the way I view this, to what degree does the average transplant recipient realize the sourcing of the organ they're receiving? And second, you mentioned a few pilot donation programs. To what degree is the average individual willing to donate an organ to create an alternative supply source?
Okay. David Kilgore and I actually interviewed many patients who received transplants, and not the ones in China, but the ones that came from abroad, and we have transcripts of some of the interviews in our book. But basically what they were told, they weren't told very much, and they were never given any records. Some of them would be told that this was a person who was sentenced to death and then executed. So they knew that, and even that is problematic, because the sourcing of organs from prisoners sentenced to death and executed is considered unethical by the transplantation profession worldwide. And as I've indicated earlier, even the Chinese government now accepts that it's wrong. And in the United States, which has the death penalty, they don't allow it anywhere, in any of the states. If a prisoner wants to donate his organs to somebody, they don't allow it. The patients, at least some of them, knew that it was happening and should have known it was wrong. But, I mean, their attitude was, I mean, obviously for many of them, getting the organ was a life-saving matter, or certainly a life-prolonging matter. So that, to them, mattered more than the concerns about the sourcing of the organs. And realistically, I mean, we can't expect the patients to enforce transplant ethics. It has to come from somewhere else. In terms of individuals willing to donate, that's very difficult. There has been a logistical problem in China because there hasn't been a donation program till recently. But even with the donation program, there's a large cultural inhibition against donation. It's very difficult for people to want to, and it's not just the Chinese culture. There's many cultures that have that inhibition. And it takes a lot of effort to overcome that inhibition. When our book first came out, I did some publicity about the book. And at the time, Prime Minister Stephen Harper, Prime Minister of Canada, was going to China to meet with the president of China, Hu Jintao. And I was asked, you know, at the launch, what should Harper say to Hu Jintao when he sees him? So I said, what Harper should say to Hu Jintao is donate your organs. Obviously to a certain extent that's facetious, but if you get the leadership, the cultural leadership, the political leadership to say, I am donating, it helps to overcome the cultural inhibition. And we need that sort of leadership from the Chinese in Canada, and we don't see it at all. I think that's what we're going to need to see.
Listen, join me, and I think I don't see any more comments or questions from you. Oh, sorry, Professor Gregory from St. John's. David?
Thanks very much. I'll be very quick. This sounds in the big picture like the fall of the Roman Empire, and you're a Gibbon. And if there's some broad analogy, and the regime is being undermined by Falun Gong, some of the other religious practices, is there a Constantine who will emerge from the power elite to see the vision and to basically find a more equitable sort of floor?
My understanding of European history is that Europe was in a total mess for a great many hundreds of years, notwithstanding Constantine.
Well, after the fall of the empire, they didn't regain their standard of living such as it was till
about
1700.
Yes. Right? It wasn't just an economic point, but
the Dark Ages.
I got you. Is there a Constantine? First of all, I don't think there is going to be a fall of this Roman Empire for a while. But
as I said
the
earlier,
seeds may be there.
I think your question is picking up on that. In the communist system, you never know what a leader thinks until he becomes the leader. Nobody knew, as I've said a number of times, what Khrushchev would do at the 20th Communist Party Congress.
What's different here, Jerry?
Pardon?
I mean, what's different here is that communism is actually delivering quality consumer goods. It has never done this before in the history of this regime. So you have like tight control of politics and consumer consumer largesse. Now, if that changes, then there'll be some problem with the regime.
Well, that gets back to the reference.
That gets back to Professor Law's question, but I, as long as they
if
have...
If you don't interrupt me, then I could finish my thought. Even in China, they don't interrupt me.
I apologize.
Of course, if the country can't keep up this phenomenal 10% growth, and if you have serious economic problems, that will enhance the challenge. But even if things continue this way, I see the number of social contradictions, as they say. And their leadership uses this term. They recognize they have very serious social contradictions now. These will increase. Khrushchev, getting back to my point, was Stalin's running dog. But he hated it, we learned at the 56th 20th Party Congress. And he instituted de-Stalinization, which was an attempt to cure some of the worst abuses of Stalinism. Gorbachev, even though he'd been to law school, no one ever suspected of what he would do once he came to power. We have in the increasingly intelligent, well-educated Chinese Communist Party leadership, people who are being scrutinized by those who were their classmates or otherwise knew them, who are waiting to see at some point some leader is going to say, we have to establish a better legal order. We have to give people more protection for their basic civil and political rights because we are a civilized country. And we can't go on with what we're doing because it's bad for our soft power. It's bad for our popularity at home and abroad. At some point, I'm confident somebody's going to do that. But I don't think it'll be in my lifetime.
When do you think it will be? That's really very intriguing.
People use the fall of the Roman Empire analogy about the United States now. The involvement in foreign wars, the internal economic problems, our financial problems. I'm more worried about how it applies to us.
I wonder if I could answer your question by quoting something from what I wrote, because in fact, in what I wrote, I did try to answer that. Anyhow, this is just reading from the end of the book, where I say even though Christianity began at least from one perspective, at least in part, as a reaction to the brutality of the Roman Empire, even though the Roman Empire persecuted Christians most cruelly, even though Christianity had no political agenda and urged its followers to render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, eventually the Roman Empire became Christian. Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity in 312 AD. Emperor Theodosius made Christianity the official religion of the empire in 391 AD. Belief in Christianity had grown so strong and belief in traditional Roman values had grown so weak that Christianity became a better organizing idiom for the empire than the old Roman values. The Chinese leadership today treats the Falun Gong as their worst enemy, imprisoning and torturing them more than any other group, killing only them and prisoners sentenced to death for their organs. At some point, they will realize that the Falun Gong are their best friends, an authentic Chinese belief system that is capable of keeping China united, capable of keeping China, to use the catchword of the muddled ideology of the current president Hu Jintao, harmonious. China one day will be predominantly Falun Gong, not because the current set of Falun Gong practitioners will one day take over the leadership, but because the leadership of China will one day become Falun Gong practitioners. In the wings of the stage of China's history stands a Constantine.
That's a pretty good ending. All right, join me in thanking the panel, which you've just done, but do it again.